بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين
QSEP.com Your step-by-step guide to learning Islam online. Tawheed Explained from the book Aqeedah to Tawheed by Shaykh Salih bin Fawzan al-Fawzan. Presentation and explanation by Dr. Abdullah Al Farsi.
The next chapter is regarding the meaning of the two shahadas and some other subjects regarding this. The first is the meaning of those two shahadas. To say La ilaha illallah, that means to believe and admit that no one deserves the worship except Allah. This is the meaning of La ilaha illallah. So La ilaha illallah does not mean there is no one who is worshipped but Allah. Because we can see by our own eyes that the gods are countless nowadays. Even the ants are worshipped somewhere. The ants and the birds and the copra and the trees. If you go from Bombay to some other place in India by car or by bus, you will see on your right and on your left temples of gods. Each god, there is a statue or picture outside showing it. You will see everything is worshipped on your way. You go for travel for 2 hours, you will see everything. So to say that La ilaha illallah means no one is worshipped but Allah, this is false. But La ilaha illallah means no one is truly worshipped, or no one deserves to be worshipped except Allah. But to say no one is worshipped except Allah, it could be the greatest kufr in this world. The greatest kufr, the greatest rejection of faith, is to say that whatever is worshipped is Allah. It's like you are approving of all false deities on this earth and saying that he who is worshipping a cow, he is worshipping Allah. And he who is worshipping whatever, he is worshipping Allah. This is the greatest kufr. There is no greater kufr than this. So this is the meaning of La ilaha illallah. So the Shaykh says, La ilaha, this is to negate and deny that anything whatsoever, be it an angel, be it a prophet, be it a saint, pious man, whatever, a martyr, anything does not deserve the worship. Anything does not deserve the right to be worshipped. Anything, anyone. This is the meaning of La ilaha. So you are actually here negating and denying. And this is the meaning of having kufr in taghut. To deny the taghut, it means that you should believe and admit that no one, whoever it might be, deserves any form of worship. And this is half of your word, La ilaha illallah. And by it itself, you have not become a Muslim. You have to go and finish the next part, and that is illallah. And this is the affirmation. The first one was the negation. And this one is the affirmation. to affirm that all the worship is deserved by Allah alone. You cannot go halfway. You cannot say, I declare that all false deities are wrong, and then stop at that. You have to say, all the worship is for Allah alone. And similarly, you cannot just be sufficient with the affirmation, saying that Allah deserves to be worshipped. But before that, you have to believe firmly that no one else deserves to be worshipped. So both parts. These are the two pillars of La ilaha illallah. The negation of all false deities and the affirmation of all the worship for Allah. These are the two pillars of La ilaha illallah. And this is the meaning of Kufr in Taghut and Imanun Billah. Kufr in Taghut means the negation. Imanun Billah means the affirmation that we mentioned. So this word, La ilaha illallah, means La ma'buda bihaqqin siwa Allah. No one is worthy of being worshipped truly, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one is worthy of being worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you have to say worthy, you have to say truly. Otherwise, we'll go back to the greatest kufr that we mentioned earlier. When you say, La ilaha illallah means La ma'buda illallah, without saying bihaq, then you will be admitting of all forms of kufr that exist in this universe. Then the Shaykh says that this word has been explained in false expressions or in false meanings, like saying La ilaha illallah means La ma'buda illallah. This is what we just mentioned, and this is false. And the second one, La ilaha illallah, they have explained it to mean La khaliqa illallah, no creator, no lord, no master but Allah, no owner but Allah. This is not La ilaha illallah. This is part of La ilaha illallah. This is part of Tawheed. This is the unity in lordship. And this was the Tawheed of the Arab pagans, the mushriks, Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab. They used to admit this. So this is not the meaning of La ilaha illallah, even though it is part of the meaning of La ilaha illallah. Another false explanation is to say La ilaha illallah means La hakimiyyata illa lillah, the Shaykh says. No rulership but for Allah. This again is part of Tawheed. It is part of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, lordship. And part of Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah also. But this is not Tawheed. And this meaning has been introduced strongly by Sayyid Qutb rahimahullah all through his tafsir, in order for you not to think that someone is lying on behalf of Sayyid Qutb. The tafsir is translated. So just pick anywhere where there is the word ilah. The easiest position for you to see is Surah An-Nas, the last surah in Qur'an. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ. Or you go to قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, and you see what Sayyid Qutb says. And you will see for yourself that he explains إله all through his book to mean the ruler, and sometimes to mean the Lord, which is again a short tafsir of La ilaha illallah, the short tafsir of ilah. And sometimes he says uluhiyyah and rububiyyah means this. So that means he doesn't distinguish between uluhiyyah and rububiyyah. Mawdudi, rahimahullah, has a small book called Al-Mustalahat Al-Arba' في القرآن, the four expressions in Qur'an. He mentioned Al-Rab and Al-Ilah. In that also, he mixed up Ilah with rulership. And Mawdudi was affected by Sayyid Qutb, indeed. And he was affected by Hasan al-Banna. Both of them, both Sayyid and Mawdudi, were affected by Hasan al-Banna. And Tawheed to them was the rulership and lordship. And they were emphasizing this. So the Shaykh says, the true tafsir of, or the true meaning of La ilaha illallah, according to the consensus of our righteous predecessors and according to the consensus of our scholars, is that La ilaha illallah means La ma'buda bihaqqin illallah. The meaning of Muhammad al-Rasulullah, to testify that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, to admit both in your heart and in your actions that he is the slave of Allah, the messenger of Allah to all mankind, and to act on that behalf, to act on the behalf of those two admissions regarding the messenger. One, that he is the slave of Allah. So you cannot say Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has any quality of Allah, like the exaggerators amongst the Sufis say. They say Muhammad was the light before the creation, that Muhammad was created from light, the light of Allah, the light of the throne, whatever. And they go much more beyond. They call him Al-Haqiqa Al-Muhammadiyya. And they say Al-Haqiqa Al-Muhammadiyya means Muhammadan truth, which means to them the whole existence. And they say that there is only one reality, one Haqiqa. And they say that Prophet Muhammad is Allah, but incarnated. So this is no worse than what the Christians say, actually. But the Christians say Jesus is the Son of Allah. And some of them say he is Allah incarnated. The same thing, same as those exaggerators amongst the Sufis say. They have a poetry, the Sufis have a poetry, which says, just don't mention that Muhammad is the Son of Allah. And then beyond that, say whatever you wish about Muhammad. And he says in that poetry that the creation has no support other than you in the most strong hardships. That in the most strong hardships, we have no one but you, O Muhammad. And then he says, you own all the favors of this life and the hereafter. And they say, you have all the knowledge which is written in the preserved tablet and beyond. So what is the difference between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And this is, of course, this exaggeration is in direct contradiction with the verses in Quran which order the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to say, I am none but a slave of Allah. Qul, say, O Muhammad, innama ana abd, I am a slave of Allah. Like you, mithlukum. I eat, I drink, I marry, I forget. So this is the meaning of Muhammadan Abdullah. Next part of testifying that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, that is to say he is the messenger of Allah. So when we say Muhammad is the slave of Allah, we explained what it means. Now when we say Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, this is very important. It means that we have no way of guidance but Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. we have no one to follow as an infallible leader but Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if you say, I follow such and such person in everything, then you are actually saying he is the messenger of Allah. And actually we fear for someone who follows some person, whoever he might be, other than the Prophet ﷺ, in this way, then that when he is asked in the grave, who is your messenger, he would not be answering. He would either say any name other than Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, the name of the person that he was treating as the Prophet. Or he would be shaken by the question and just say, I don't know, I don't know. And he'll be beaten on his head in such a manner that everything will be hearing the sound of this beating, as has been explained in the true hadith. So to say Muhammad is the messenger of Allah means that you have no right to treat the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam like the statements of this person or that person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it in Qur'an, لَا تَجْعَلُوا دُعَاءَ الرَّسُولِ بَيْنَكُمْ كَدُعَاءِ بَعْضِكُمْ بَعْضًا فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Do not treat the call of the messenger to you to do something or not to do something as the call of one of you to the other. Let those who act different than his order, the order of the Prophet ﷺ, his sunnah, be aware of two evils, one of two evils, no other choice. The first, which is the greatest evil, is shirk, that you fall into shirk as a punishment for your arrogance and for giving a priority to anything from someone other than the messenger to what the messenger has ordered you. This is one of the greatest sins. And it is the sunnah of Allah, it is the way of Allah, as he said it in his book, that as a punishment for your sin, he'll make you fall into something else, either a sin or an innovation or even shirk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَلَمَّا زَاغُوا أَزَاغَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ. When they deviated from the guidance that Allah has shown them, then Allah has punished them with more deviation. فَلَمَّا زَاغُوا أَزَاغَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ. That's why if someone acts different than the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, maybe in the beginning he'll be acting not knowing that he is doing so. Someone would remind him, and then it will be cleared to him so that he has no other way out. If he still does not repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah will make him fall into a more severe sin. And that is, he might consider this thing which he is doing is better than the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Therefore, he will be committing shirk, great shirk. That's why Imam Ahmad rahimahullah explained this verse when Allah says, let those who act different from his order be aware of two things. The first is the affliction and the second is the severe punishment. Imam Ahmad said, do you know what is the affliction? The affliction is shirk. And Sufyan al-Thawri said, the affliction is to make your heart sealed so that you will have no chance of seeing the truth. And that is even worse. That is even worse than shirk. So this is the meaning of Shahadat anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. We have contemporary writers, thinkers, as they say, even though they are the furthest from the true thinking, but they are called Islamic thinkers. You have heard about this institute, Islamic Institute of Thought in Washington, who published the books of Alwan and Ghazali and Qaradawi and people from this gang of false thinking. It's very easy for them, if you go to their books, to see them reject a true hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, like drinking tea. They reject it like drinking tea, like sipping tea, not only drinking, enjoying it, like that. Muhammad al-Ghazali says in his introduction of Fiqh al-Sira, he puts some kind of fundamentals in there, fundamentals of the devil. He says, I cannot accept such and such hadith in Bukhari and Muslim because it is against Quran. And I don't care that it is in Bukhari and Muslim. I accept that hadith which came in At-Tabari, which does not have this word that he doesn't want to accept, even though the one in Tabari is weak. So he makes way for his followers to reject the strong hadiths, which all the scholars of hadith approve to be true. And he says, this is only an example. And I have many other hadiths that are in Bukhari and Muslim, which are like this. Of course, this is an example of this school, devilish school, which do not treat the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the Messenger of Allah, even though they utter it by their tongue. So then the Shaykh explains the two pillars of La ilaha illallah, which I already mentioned. He quotes the verse in Quran about Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, when he said, I declare that I am innocent of all that which you worship falsely. And I declare that I only worship the one who has created me. And this is Surah Az-Zukhruf, verse 26 and 27. So the Shaykh emphasizes again here the two words, innani bara, I am innocent. This is the negation that we pointed out to. This is the kufr and taghut. And then, illa alladhi fatarani, this is the affirmation again. Illa, this is the affirmation that we mentioned earlier, illa Allah. Or yakfur bittaghut is the negation, wa yu'min billah, to have faith in Allah. This is the affirmation. And then the pillars of Muhammad al-Rasulullah, again, two pillars, to say his slave and his messenger. And by this, we are avoiding any form of exaggeration, like the Sufis or some of the Sufis do, where they put Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam above the degree of humanity. And sometimes they take him up to the rank of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we avoid also the deviation of those who belittle the position of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by rejecting his orders in ugly means and ugly ways. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is indeed the most perfect amongst the creation. And the meaning of the worshipper here, or the slave, it means the most sincere slave in worship, which is a great honor for him to be the most sincere worshipper. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned about him in Qur'an to say that he is only a human like us. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has applied this degree of being a slave in the best way. In the best way. In the battle of Badr, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was seen to be raising his hands and insisting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers his call, to the degree that he was humiliating himself so much in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And every slave should humiliate himself so much in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are a slave, and Allah is the master, and Allah is the Lord, and Allah is the owner of everything, the most mighty. So who else deserves this position, that you should humble yourself in front of him? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam showed his slavery to Allah in many, many ways. In his insisting on Allah, in his weeping, in his dua, in his insisting on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though he is the most honorable creature and the most honorable human, but still, he showed his need, his dire need, his great need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the position of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And many of these nations unfortunately fall into the two categories of deviation that I mentioned, to one extreme or the other extreme. Alhamdulillah wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. This is a continuation from the book Aqeedah at-Tawheed by Shaykh Salih al-Fawzaan. The topic today is about the conditions of La ilaha illallah. Those conditions are all derived from the book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some scholars, or most of the scholars, said there are seven conditions. Some scholars added another condition, which actually is included in those seven. The word La ilaha illallah, or the testification La ilaha illallah, is not valid without satisfying those seven conditions. The first condition is the knowledge, meaning to know the meaning of La ilaha illallah. And of course, you cannot apply any of the other conditions without knowing the meaning of La ilaha illallah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Qur'an, فَعَلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. This is an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to know La ilaha illallah, to know the meaning, فَعَلَمْ. This is an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we must know the meaning of La ilaha illallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said, إِلَّا مَنْ شَهِدَ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. إِلَّا مَنْ شَهِدَ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. Except those who testify to the truth, which is La ilaha illallah, while they knowing the meaning of it. Otherwise, it will not be a testification. If you testify to La ilaha illallah or to anything else without knowing that which you are testifying with, then it is not a valid testification. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said also in the hadith, عَلَى مِثْلِهَا فَاشْهَدْ, when he pointed to the sun in the midst of the day and in a clear sky, and he told the man, as you see this clear sun, you should testify. Your testification should be on something that you know so clearly, as you know that the sun is rising right now in the midst of this day, in the middle of a clear sky. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man mata wa huwa ya'lam annahu la ilaha illa Allah dakhala al-jannah." He who dies knowing la ilaha illa Allah, he will enter paradise. So this is the first condition of la ilaha illa Allah. And we mentioned earlier the meaning of la ilaha illa Allah. So one should say this word knowing its meaning. Many people nowadays who say it, unfortunately, they don't understand from the meaning of La ilaha illallah except a portion of the meaning. Yani they understand it partially, not totally. That is why they say La ilaha illallah and they supplicate to other than Allah, which means that they don't understand the meaning of La ilaha illallah, because La ilaha illallah means no worship whatsoever should be devoted to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And supplication is a great worship. It's not only a worship, but it's a great worship. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Al-Hajju Arafah. Hajj is Arafah. Arafah is one of the pillars of Hajj. But due to its great importance, he said, Arafah is the Hajj. And he also said, Ad-du'a'u huwa al-ibadah. Dua, supplication, is the worship. It's one of the forms of worship. But due to its importance, the Prophet ﷺ said, Ad-du'a'u huwa al-ibadah. And what the Prophet ﷺ said is very clear in Qur'an. Like the verse speaking about Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about him, that he told his people that I will seclude myself from you and that which you worship besides Allah. And then he said, and I supplicate to my Lord only. So first he said worship, then he said what? Supplicate. Which means that he is equaling supplication to worship. And he said, I am innocent of that which you worship Allah with. And I only supplicate to Allah alone. He didn't say, I only worship Allah alone. He said, I only supplicate to Allah alone. To show that supplication is worship. Also, the other verse in Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ ادعوني استجب لكم ان الذين يستكبرون عن عبادتي. Same thing. Allah says, supplicate to me. And then he says, those who are full with false pride and therefore not worship me. He didn't say not supplicate to me. Why? Because worship is supplication, or supplication actually is worship. Worship could be supplication and could be other forms of worship. But supplication is indeed worship, because supplication is the most important aspect of worship. That is why the first shirk occurred in supplication. As Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, after mentioning the shirk of the people in his days, supplicating to the awliya, things like that, he said, وَهَذَا أَصْلُ شِرْكِ الْعَالَمِ. وَهَذَا أَصْلُ شِرْكِ الْعَالَمِ. This is the dominant or the foundation of all the shirk in the world, whether in the past nations or in the coming nations. So, this is the meaning of knowledge about La ilaha illallah. One must know La ilaha illallah. To know La ilaha illallah doesn't mean that you know that Allah is the creator and the provider. This is part of the knowledge. This is not the knowledge. This knowledge will not save you from hellfire. That's why the scholars, when they say the condition of knowledge, they say Al-ilm alladhi yanfi al-jahl. Meaning that you should have a minimum of knowledge which make you negate any form of shirk or deny any form of shirk. If you have that much, then you have enough, meaning the minimum. Otherwise, the knowledge of La ilaha illallah could be much, much more. وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. And above every knowledgeable person, there is a knowledgeable person. Even Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, who was one of the greatest knowledgeable people about La ilaha illallah, asked for more. And he said, when Allah told him, do you have any doubt? Of course, Allah knows that he doesn't have any doubt. But to show us why he asked, Ibrahim alayhi salam said, Bala, walakin liyatma'inna qalbi. It's just for more confidence, for more knowledge, more yaqeen. So he said, I have no doubt, I have yaqeen, but I want more. So the minimum knowledge that you should know is that you should know enough which make you not fall into great shirk or small shirk even. If you have enough knowledge about La ilaha illallah that will save you from falling into great shirk, then you are a Muslim and you are a believer. And when you don't have enough knowledge to save you from great shirk, you are not a Muslim at all. If you have enough knowledge to save you from great shirk, but you still need more knowledge to save you from small shirk, then you are a Muslim, but you are sinning for not learning what's a must on you to learn. That is to save you from any form of shirk, small or big. The next condition is the surety of the heart. And the surety is a condition in all issues of faith. So how about La ilaha illallah, which is at the top list of faith? Any belief that you believe in Islam, there must be surety. And also there must be knowledge about it. So those conditions actually are not only for La ilaha illallah, for any belief. For any belief. And for any faith. Any faith in your heart must have those seven conditions. If you don't have those seven conditions, then you are not faithful. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Qur'an, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. إِنَّمَا means that there is no but. Okay? That means there is no faithful but those who believe in Allah and His Messenger and have no doubt afterwards. So if you have doubts, that means you are not amongst those who believe in Allah and His Messenger. And what is meant by doubts are those doubts which remain in one's heart, not things which pop up in your mind or come and go easily. Those are not a condition for faith. Even Sahaba, who were the strongest in faith, things like that would pop up in their minds. And they used to complain to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of them said, O Messenger of Allah, such things come up to our minds, we'd rather be dead than to speak them out, or something like that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the meaning of the hadith, I don't remember now the exact words. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do you really find this in your hearts? They said, yes. He said, that is by itself faith. That is indeed faith, the meaning of the hadith. Why? Because the fact that they dislike what comes to their mind to the degree that they prefer death over it shows that they are strongly faithful. Otherwise, they would go along with it and they would not be hating it and they would not be fearing You see? So that shows how strong in their faith they were. Because Shaitan could come to you at any time and throw doubts in your mind, in your heart, about Allah, about this religion, about Qur'an, about Sunnah. And this is from Shaitan, not from you. So if you dislike this in your heart to the degree that you'd rather die than having such a thing or believing in such a thing, then that shows how strong you are in faith. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to one of his companions, anyone whom you meet behind this wall who testify to La ilaha illallah with surety in his heart, then give him the glad tidings of paradise. This is in Bukhari or Muslim, one of them. So surety is a condition. It is a condition. It is a pillar. It is something that you cannot do without. And also here, the scholars, when they mention this condition, they say the condition of surety which denies any doubt or which negates any doubt. Just like they said, knowledge which denies any ignorance. Here they say the same thing. Because surety is degrees. So you have a minimum. A minimum which clears all doubts in your mind. This is condition. If you don't have that minimum, you are not a Muslim. You are not a Muslim, you are not faithful. The third condition is the acceptance of this word, what it means, what it implies. The acceptance and the declaration. You cannot keep it secret. Yani, if you hear that there is a certain person who is, for example, a Christian priest, but they found him pray like Muslims in secret. You see, we hear such stories in Egypt and other places. Some Christian Egyptian who became a Muslim, he said, I opened the door suddenly and I found my boss, the priest, is praying like us. And then he told me, don't tell anyone, because if you tell anyone, then I'll be harmed, or something like this. So you have to declare it. La ilaha illallah has to be declared. If you lose your position in dunya, that's not an excuse. It's not an excuse. You have to declare it. Otherwise, Hercules, when he received the message from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wanted to become a Muslim because he was a very knowledgeable man. And he found in the books that they had that Prophet Muhammad fits all the descriptions of the last messenger. As a matter of fact, he had Prophet Muhammad's picture in his books. And not only Prophet Muhammad's picture, but Abu Bakr's picture also. Yani, because there were descriptions, so many descriptions in their books about the Prophet, they drew him according to such descriptions. And not only that, but they drew Abu Bakr according to those descriptions which they have in their books, which shows that they had no excuse. You see, in the story of Abu Sufyan, when he was not a Muslim, he was still not a Muslim, he came to Hercules, and Hercules started to asking him about Prophet Muhammad, asking him questions. All those questions, their answers matched the fact that he's a messenger of Allah. Then Hercules told his servants to bring the box with a big golden lock, and he said, open it. And he started showing Abu Sufyan pictures of prophets according to the descriptions they have. until the one before last picture, it was the picture of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "Is this him?" He said, "Yes, that's him." Abu Sufyan said. Then he showed him the last picture and he said, "And is this his companion?" He said, "Yes, that's Abu Bakr." And he was sure, Hercules, that this is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he decided to become a Muslim. And he stood up in the castle and he closed all the gates, okay? And he said to the people that I have received a message from a man whom I believe is the messenger, truly messenger of Allah. You see? But they became so angry, the priests, and they started showing signs of discomfort and just like mules, huh? Going around like mules. They wanted to find the gates and leave. So Hercules felt weak and he said, if I turn those people against me now, I'll lose my kingship. So he called them back. He said, come back. I'm only testing your faith. And he did not become a Muslim. Abu Talib also did not satisfy this condition, declaration of La ilaha illallah, even though in his poetry he said clearly that Muhammad is a prophet of Allah and that his religion is the truth. He declared this in his poetry. But he refused to testify to La ilaha illallah because he didn't want people to say later on that he changed the religion of his forefathers. That's all. Yani, nothing from dunya that he can use in his lifetime. No, it's a reputation after his death. You see how guidance is only up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani he knew that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the messenger of Allah. And he felt very strong about it. And yet, just for an issue of dunya, which is not even in his lifetime, you see, he didn't want people to say after he dies that Abu Talib changed the religion of his forefathers. And he did not declare La ilaha illallah. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will not guide those whom you love. It is only Allah who guides whom he wills. The third condition is this, we mentioned al-qabul, the acceptance and the declaration. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in his book, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. That say La ilaha illallah, they become full with false pride and they don't say it. Not because they don't think it's true. See, they know it's true, but due to false pride. You see, just like the saying of Allah, وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًّا. That their denial was not because of not believing it is true, but it was because of seeking the false highness in this life or being full with false pride in themselves. So this by itself is great kufr. To turn back from the truth for this reason, this is kufr, great kufr. You don't have to deny the truth to be a kafir. Actually, it's only Jahm and the followers of Jahm who say that there is no kufr except by denial. And anyone who says this is following Jahm ibn Safwan. The fourth condition is the submission, inqiyad. And this is a very strong condition of La ilaha illallah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يُسْلِمْ وَجْهَهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَهُوَ مُحْسِنٌ فَقَدْ إِسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى. العروة الوثقى is لا إله إلا الله, as Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما explained it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you have to submit your face to Allah, that is sincerity. وَهُوَ مُحْسِنٌ, while you are doing the righteous action. In your submission, you have to do the righteous deed, and that is the submission. So sincerity and submission. Submission means that you have to accept every right of La ilaha illallah, salat, siyam, zakat, hajj, jihad, everything, all obligations. You cannot deny anyone. If you deny anyone in your heart, you are not a Muslim. And some of those actions, if you deny them by not doing them, you are not a Muslim also, you see. يعني to have respect for Quran, if you show any action of disrespect, you are not a Muslim. Even though this is an action of your limbs, still you are not a Muslim. Why? Because it cannot be disattached from your heart. There are actions which cannot be disattached from what's in your heart. No one can spit on Quran with belief in his heart that Quran is the word of Allah and it should be respected. You see? So if he does such a thing, that means there is no belief in his heart. There is no belief in his heart that this is the book of Allah and the word of Allah. It's a sign of that, no doubt. So submission is a condition of La ilaha illallah. And submission, of course, يعني has 2 degrees, not one. First degree is submission which negates kufr. يعني if you don't have it, you are a kafir. And the second level of submission, qiyad, is the one which decreases your faith. Because there are a lot of actions in Islam, even though you believe that you must do them, or it is favorable to do them, but you become lazy or for any other reason and you don't do them, so your faith becomes decreased, but not lost totally, not lost totally. So one have to be very careful also in this issue, submission, because those who rush into takfir depend on this verse about submission, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثم لا يجدوا في أنفسهم حرجا مما قضيت ويسلموا تسليما. This last part, ويسلموا تسليما, submission. You see? Submission. And also the part before it, that you don't find any doubts or harsh feelings in your heart about the rule of Allah, this is also from submission. It's also from submission. So those people who don't understand this verse, they consider any form of not submitting as great kufr, which is not true. Because the one who is, for example, cursing Allah, he is definitely not submitting. So he's a kafir, because he is cursing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and cursing Allah cannot be in any way at the same time with faith in the heart or Islam in the heart. They cannot be together, you see. But not doing a certain obligation or doing some sins, this is also not submitting, practically not submitting, but this is not kufr, this is only a sin. And The verse applies to both. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. By your Lord, they will not be faithful until they submit. Huh? Okay, so if they did not submit, they will not be faithful. Then what will they be? Either kafirs, if it is from the first kind, or Muslims with short faith, if it is from the second kind. You see? This is clear, inshallah. This is very important because this is a reply on Khawarij. The Khawarij, whether in the past or now, they don't have this. They don't understand the levels. No, it's one level for them. Black and white, as they say. You see? And therefore, if you don't have faith, then you are kafir to them. See? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, by your Lord, they will not be faithful. The Prophet ﷺ says, Wallahi la yu'min, Wallahi la yu'min, Wallahi la yu'min. By Allah, he is not faithful. By Allah, he is not faithful. By Allah, he is not faithful. They said, who is it, O Messenger of Allah? The Prophet ﷺ said, the one whose neighbor is not safe from his evil. The one whose neighbor is not safe or does not feel safe from his evil. So the Prophet ﷺ said, Wallahi la yu'min. Wallahi la yu'min. Wallahi la yu'min. Not only once, twice, three times, and swearing each time, but still this means that this person who is doing evil to his neighbor is sinning, not committing kufr. You see? And the Prophet ﷺ said, لا يدخل الجنة مدمن خمر. Someone who drinks intoxicating drinks and becomes addicted, he will not enter paradise. So those people, amongst them this guy called Abu Basir, who deserves to be called Abu Blind, not Abu Basir. Basir is the one who sees. He comes to this hadith and he says, this means those who are addicted to drugs and alcohol drinks and even fornication, they are not Muslims. Why? He said, because they start by sinning and then it becomes to the degree where they love this sin so much that they declare their allegiance according to this sin and such and such. So what? It's still a sin. It's a bigger sin. It's a bigger sin. The stronger it becomes, the worse it is. But that doesn't make it kufr. You see? It doesn't become kufr by that. You see? We have a lot of so-called du'at nowadays who fall into this trap. Yani they say, for example, they say, if someone does a certain sin and then foolishly, ignorantly, he speaks about it amongst his friends as if he is proud he did it. You see? That we went to Bangkok and we did this and this and this, you know. Because he knows they will laugh and they will say, yeah, that's, you are really something, you are daring. You are. So he says it, right? So they say, that means he's a kafir. And most of the sinners do this, you see. If he's a kafir, and the one who is addicted a kafir, then there is no sinner who is not a kafir. Where are the sinners? Then all are kafirs, you see. And those same people, if you tell them, those who supplicate to other than Allah, they are kafirs, they tell you, no, you have to be very careful. You cannot call them kafirs. You have to establish the proof against them. Have you established the truth against them? You see, it's very easy for them to call sinners kafirs, just like that. But when it comes to mushriks, they say, no, you have to be very careful. Don't call them kafirs. And the fifth condition is the truth, which the scholars say opposite to hypocrisy. The truth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اتقوا الله وكونوا مع الصادقين. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. They say we are believers, and yet they are not believers. يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. They deceive Allah and those who believe. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said eventually, وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْذِبُونَ. They will taste severe punishment for their lie in faith. Biggest lie. It's a kufr, great kufr. Nifaq, hypocrisy, great hypocrisy. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, من قال لا إله إلا الله صدقا من قلبه. Truly, from his heart, صدقا من قلبه. Not just by tongue, to please certain people, or to gain some worldly gains. You see, one knows that he cannot marry a Muslim woman except by declaring Islam. So he says, let's trick them, you know, and say La ilaha illallah by tongue, but in his heart he does not believe in Tawheed. He does not believe in La ilaha illallah. He doesn't even know what it means. Just to trick them and marry their daughter. So he's not a Muslim. He's not a Muslim. He is a kafir. Maybe in the eyes of people, they could consider him a Muslim. If they don't know about him, they cannot go into his heart. Yani, I cannot tell him, you are a kafir because we don't know what's in your heart. Unless I am 100% sure that he doesn't know the meaning of La ilaha illallah, I cannot go and judge what's in his heart. But he is not a Muslim if he says it by his tongue, when the reality is that in his heart he doesn't believe in it. So he's not a Muslim. Those who say La ilaha illallah by their tongue and at the same time treat dead people as gods. So where is La ilaha illallah? This is hypocrisy. It's hypocrisy. The sixth condition is the sincerity. That is to purify your faith in Allah and all other actions, purify them from all other goals except pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whether it is La ilaha illallah or any other action, salat, siyam, you have to purify your intention and make your sincerity for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are many verses supporting the sincerity, and there are many hadiths. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah made hellfire haram on those who say La ilaha illallah seeking the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, narrated by Bukhari and Muslim. The seventh condition is the love for this word and what it means. And this love for this word and what it means also means love for those who say it, truly. And not only that, but this love will not be accepted without hatred for its opposite, and without hatred for those who are on the opposite of La ilaha illallah, whatever their name is. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Qur'an, لا تجد قوما يؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر يوادون من حاد الله ورسوله. You will not find a group of people who believe in Allah and the Day of Judgment, and at the same time have love for those who oppose to Allah and His Messenger. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forbidden us from loving His enemies. He said, لا تتخذوا عدوي وعدوكم أولياء. Don't take my enemies and your enemies as allies. يعني Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, they are my enemies. How could they be your friends? How? If they are my enemies and you love me and you want to obey me, they should be your enemies. A natural result, right? So you cannot say, oh Allah, I love you, but I love your enemy at the same time. You cannot say this. But of course, this term, hatred, should not be understood in the way that the Western people understand it, and even some ignorant Muslims understand it. You know, hatred does not mean that you do injustice to them. No. As a matter of fact, hating them doesn't mean that you love good for them also. You love for them to become Muslims and pious people and go to paradise and enjoy paradise. So there is no contradiction between your hatred for them because they are enemies of Allah, because they are insulting Allah, they are setting up rivals with Allah, they are saying there is a son of Allah amongst humans, creatures. But you have no right to do any injustice to them. If they come into your country as workers or tourists or in any form, they come on a condition of being guaranteed safety. So no one, any Muslim, has no right to harm them in any way, let alone to kill them or do something like that to them. As a matter of fact, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, من آذى ذميا لم يرح رائحة الجنة. You see, he who harms a Christian or Jew who are under the oath of Muslims, he will not smell the smell of paradise, which means it's a major sin in Islam. So if it's a major sin to harm them, then how about murdering them? So it's not easy. The Khawarij nowadays, they say, one of the proofs that we are not Khawarij is that because we kill those non-Muslims. You see? They say this is one of the proofs that we are not Khawarij. We say this is one of the proofs that you are much more ignorant than the Khawarij before and much more worse than the Khawarij before. The Khawarij before, because they were praying a lot and fasting a lot, they had some fear of Allah. Therefore, they acted by what they knew. They knew from the Prophet ﷺ to respect the rights of those non-Muslims who are living amongst Muslims, that they have some rights. So they respected that. So they did not kill them. And they did not harm them. To the degree that one of them wanted to take one date from the garden of a Christian, and the other one told him, no, don't take it. This is not halal for us. You see? So they were, to a certain degree, they had some fear and piety. Huh? But nowadays, the Khawarij are much more ignorant. They shed the blood of Muslims in the name of jihad, and they shed the blood of those who have يعني, an allegiance of safety or a trust of safety in the Islamic countries because of their ignorance and because of their lack of piety. Not because they are different from the Khawarij before. They are worse than the Khawarij before. And of course, not all of them are Khawarij. A lot of them are just ignorance, okay, who are fooled by someone. But still, there are some who are actually Khawarij.